I'm Jeff Koinange, and this is Jeff Koinange Live. It looks like we were waiting for the rain to go away, and it has, and we have a great show for you tonight. It's all about the state of security in the nation. A lot of people asking, is it time for Olelenku to go? I'm going to ask my guest that tonight, right here sitting next to me in the middle. The man in the middle himself, the House Majority Leader, Aidan Duale, and on the far right, former Deputy Speaker, former Member of Parliament for Lagdera, Farah Marlin. They're cousins, they're from the same clan, they speak the same language, on opposite sides of the divide. Twitter handles, at Farah Marlin, at Honorable Aidan Duale, at Koinange Jeff, the hashtag is JKL. Start tweeting, we have a live audience for the first time in a long time. Young men and women from Daystar University. Shout out to you guys. We're going to have a great show. We have a fire extinguisher. Just in case. Sorry, Moshimiwa. This one's fresh. It's so fresh. All right. State of security in the nation. Gentlemen, welcome to the show. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam.
Good to see you, gentlemen.
Wa alaikum salam.
Look, and I know there's other things to talk about. We'll talk about ODM, the future of, if there is indeed. But first, state of security. Kapedo, 21 police officers are slaughtered. President goes in, demands guns to be returned. So far, maybe half of them have been returned. Maybe 10, 11, maybe a dozen. 2 years ago, Baragoi, 42 ADs slaughtered in the same region. Come on, Mushimiwa, this is terrible in this day and age at this time. And don't say it's because of Pokots to Kana Samburus. We have a serious situation in this country.
First, I want to confirm all the 21 guns have been returned.
Come on, no way.
They have been returned. I speak for government, you don't. 21 guns have been returned. The operation is still on. It's an operation carried by the National Security Intelligence Council. It is intelligence-led. KDF are in West Pokot within the confines of the Constitution, Article 241, 3B and 3C.
What's to avoid another situation like this?
And this government will make sure that not only in Pokot, in Turkana, in Samburu, in Mombasa, all illegal owners of firearms will be dealt with within the confines of the law.
Moshimiwa, they keep saying this. They keep saying this. Going forward, this will not happen. Isn't this the same rhetoric all the time?
Jeff, to be very honest to you, when we are discussing the state of the security in the country, any sensible citizen of this country will shed the party affiliations and the divides. Absolutely. And the differences. We have a common goal ourselves.
Absolutely.
To support the security machinery and the government of the day to make sure that security is firmed up and stabilized.
Is it?
Now let me tell you, it's not. It's being handled in the most lackluster, the most unprofessional, and in a manner that essentially is not going to yield any permanent fruits. To begin with, you don't deal with the maintenance of law and order using the military. This is not an external invasion on this country. If the firepower of the bandits or the cattle rustlers or the terrorists, whatever you want to call them, a little bit exceeds the capacity of the police, then you have the General Service Unit, which is a paramilitary.
But still part of the police.
Part of the police and very powerful.
They are police.
And
the police.
Paramilitary, yes. You can use them. You can also use and call for a limited element from the military, for example, the air cavalry, in the event that there's a concentration of these people and you have to deal with it more as a concentrated target. But to go and send the tanks and send the army and send the helicopter gunships and send all this to go and maintain law and order, what does that tell you? One, the government has panicked. Two, I like it when my cousin says that this is now led by the security intelligence. Fantastic. It's going to be for the first time for a good number of years. If that's the case, it's good. These people can be dealt with in a manner that doesn't take that much firepower, that doesn't disrupt the lives of so many people, and you can get the maximum results in the shortest possible time.
Moshimiwa, let me ask you this question.
Let me first say that the deployment of Kenya Defense Forces is not unique to this government. It is a provision that is in the Constitution. The Kenya Defense Forces can be deployed internally through two options. One, Article 241, Subarticle 3B says the Kenya or the National Police Service can call for assistance from the Kenya Defense Forces in situations of emergency and disaster. A good example was the Westgate, an emergency. And they report back to Parliament.
Yeah.
On the equipment, the soldier they have used, the amount of resources.
But Westgate was a disaster for the military, you know that.
No,
it was a disaster.
No, let me first finish. The second option is for them to get a prior approval of Parliament to maintain law and order and peace and security. That is what the KDF forces are doing in Pokot and Turkana border.
For how long?
This is not the first time. We use KDF forces to maintain law and order in Tana River. In last government, you're aware?
Yeah.
When over 100 civilians were butchered by militia within Tana River, Tana Delta. So it's not the first time. But let me come to the genesis. The security situation in our country is historical. You must first and foremost invest in your security system. Over the years, the government of Mzee Kenyatta, the government of Moi, the government of Kibaki, never invested in the security system of our country. This government has invested heavily in equipment, in personnel. Every year, they are to recruit 10,000 men and women. Gave for the first time insurance to the men and women of the police. For the first time, a very robust housing policy. Now, what are we lacking? We are lacking the men and the women who are in charge.
Correct.
The leadership.
Mheshimiwa, I was going to ask that question. He just talked about leadership right now. Is it time to let Olelenku go? Honestly, for the sake of this country. People have been asking this question.
Frankly, if you ask me about Olelenku, Olelenku has never had a security experience before. You don't have to necessarily have a security experience for you as a minister to be there in charge of provincial administration and internal security. That is supposed to be done by the experts. It's just like the president. He's the commander-in-chief of the Kenya Armed Forces. He doesn't have to have the slightest or the least idea about how the military functions. The problem is systemic. Let me be very honest with you. It's systemic. In trying to expand on the horizon of civil liberties in the country, we more or less politicized every institution of the country. We politicized the police, we politicized many other institutions of the country. So much so that you have too many political, quasi-political positions in the system right now who cannot be touched, they're sacred cows.
Right, let me ask
Let me just finish telling
before you. Before you do that, yes. Real quick, everybody talks about John Michuki. The late John Michuki. Sorry, talk to you as well for a bit. When it comes to internal security, don't you want someone there who, when you look at him, when you see him, when he says something, you feel safer?
At the time when John Michuki was there, at the time when Saitoti was there, for the best part, the commissioner of police was Major General Hussein Ali. Major General Hussein Ali was in a man of his own class, exceptional,
yeah,
and did work that essentially has no equal, that I can tell you. I mean, in terms of the personality itself, the man had too many things. He was an air cavalry a pilot himself and a commander before. He was a special forces. He was, he had too many things.
And he got the job done. Do you agree? Do you agree, Mheshimiwa?
Jeff, I agree. I mean, Major General Ali did extraordinary
job
during his tenure. Mm. Of course, he had people in our country who had issues with him. I mean,
yeah,
there were the issues of the extrajudicial killing.
Yes,
but there are those of us who believe that if it was not for General Ali, even in 2007,
we would not have a country today.
2008 post-election violence, maybe Kenya could have been a different country today. But coming to the point whether Joseph Olelenku should throw the hat, that I think is far-fetched, in my opinion. Olelenku is an appointee of the president. Olelenku works with a team that heads different arms of the security apparatus. We have the intelligence, we have the military, we have the criminal investigation.
Yes.
We have the IG, we have his two deputies. I mean, security is a collective. Even us sitting here, Kenyans have a role to play in maintaining law and order. But I agree with you. Everything in our country, the buck stops with one person. Ultimately, security matters. If the country goes wrong, the buck stops with the president.
And what if these are the organs you mentioned? What if they don't like Olele? What if they don't agree with him? What if they don't want him there? They could easily sabotage him, make life difficult for him.
I don't think so. I don't think it's not a question of liking Olelenku or not.
You have too many
Farah has said is that when we were making our new constitution, our constitution was driven mainly by the civil society activists. For the first time, we're the only country that has two police forces. Globally, administrative police and the regular police.
Yeah.
We have two parallel police force that has different command structure.
Maybe that's a problem.
Maybe that's a problem. And that is now the work of the legislators. And for us as a country to look back and say, are we having too many command centers? Do we have one police under one man called Kimaiyo? Is Kimaiyo throwing the shots? But I can tell you for one, having said all that, the pastoral community in which me and him we belong, there's the Pokot, the Somalis, the Turkanas, the Samburus. We must leave the outdated culture of cattle rustling.
Yeah.
Stock theft. People are doing serious business in Nairobi Stock Exchange.
Yeah.
We are doing stock theft in the 21st century.
Imagine.
At least for the Somalis and the Maasai we have left.
Primitive.
Very primitive. Our friends, the Turkanas, the Pokots, and the Samburus must leave this outdated culture of senseless killing, of cattle rustling, stock theft. That will ultimately affect education, their health care, and the whole thing of devolution.
Yeah.
Turkana County got the highest,
yes.
9 billion. West Pokot County has 5 billion. They have no time to implement that 9 or 5 billion to the benefit of their people.
Maybe they're too busy buying guns.
They're killing themselves or they're killing the security forces.
Jeff, let me tell you, we don't have to reinvent the wheel.
Mm.
Honorable Duale has put it very well. The Somalis and the Maasais have gone out of cattle rustling. Why? There is a powerful social emancipation within those two societies.
Absolutely.
One is the Maasais, because of their proximity to Nairobi, were able to pretty much take advantage of many things, education, you know, entrepreneurship, their land, which is very, 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 very rich. They get the Mara Reserve and all these benefits that they have. The Somalis, being an enterprising society and a trading society for hundreds of years, have also managed to come into all the urban settings in this country. And the social fabric of the community is that when you make it very well doing business in Kitale and you're a Somali, you take care of families back at home. You see what I mean?
Mm.
So there is that social net, social security net. What have we done for the Pokots and the Turkanas in terms of serious development? And I'm going to draw a parallel on this
one. They have devolution.
What have they done for themselves?
Listen to me carefully.
Mm.
You remember how the Karamojas used to be a thorn in the flesh in Uganda, in the side of the Ugandan government and the entire Ugandan societies who live around them, including the Kenyans also, the Turkanas, the Pokots. They used to come and rustle.
Yeah.
Museveni created a minister for Karamojong, a minister for Karamojong only, and
his wife.
Mm.
His wife is a minister for Karamojong.
Initially, he started off with a Karamoja. Intellectual who was, I forget the name, he actually used to work later on with the UN, and later on progressively until now it's in the hands of his wife. They put up schools, they put infrastructures, they did so much investments into Karamojong, so much so that, I mean, there's already a middle class Karamojong, there's an upper class elite Karamojong, there's a whole transformation of the society itself. Unless we are able to transform this pastoralists, this problem will never
be found a solution for. Let me tell you one thing.
Yeah.
As a pastoralist, as a leader in this country, I'm very much disappointed. When you know a senator stands up before the commander-in-chief of the Kenyan Defense Forces, the president, and says, Mr. President, you know it was a mistaken identity.
Mm.
We didn't want to kill your soldiers. We wanted to kill Kenya police reservists. That is shameful.
Yeah, he was on the show last week. Imagine. Imagine.
Was he? Yeah, he was. You should have thrown him to the swimming pool.
That cannot be justified.
Let me tell you. Yeah. Let's call a spade a spade.
The leadership, at least was very honest.
The leadership from the Poko, the Turkana. You know, when you see a gang of 10 people being told by a magician in Mombasa that if you invade Nyali barracks, the soldiers, the garrison will not see you. And the 9 guys go there.
With pangas.
With the pangas. With a guy who has heavy power. But in a nutshell, we have said yesterday in Parliament that this government, under the leadership of President Uhuru Kenyatta, we must dismantle drug dealers, we must dismantle money launderers, terrorists, cattle rustlers, the Mungikis, the MRCs, for Kenya to be safe.
All but the Al-Shabaab. You're mentioning Al-Shabaab.
Terrorists. They are. Today,
before we go and break, Mheshimiwa.
But today we must commend the police.
What do they do?
I mean, the Lenkos and the Kimayos.
What do they do?
10 high-profile terrorists, among them 2 ladies, who were sent to do what was supposed to be done, like Westgate, were apprehended. We must give credit. Okay. It's in the news, yes.
Credit where it's due. Yeah. Before we go on commercial break, by the way, Twitter handle is @FarahMarlam, @Honorable Aidan Dwale, @Koinange Jeff. The hashtag is JKL. James Krop Lochita says, Dwale strongly condemned KDF deployment in Garissa in 2012. Yeah. I haven't seen you condemning the Kapedo operations. Why?
Because in Garissa, we didn't kill people.
What did you kill?
Nothing.
What did the KDF do in Garissa?
No, let me tell
exactly
you.
Exactly what they're doing right now in Kapedo.
The KDF worked. You asked me a question.
Yes.
I condemned, and I'll still condemn. And the matter is in court of the KDF incursion in 2011 in Garissa market. Because they worked from the barracks, they started beating innocent people. In Kapedo, it's a different matter.
Jeff,
Kapedo,
anytime.
21 Kenyan soldiers were killed.
Yes.
Ambushed.
Slaughtered.
A dozen of civilians were killed. Arms were stolen. That is an aggression. What happened in Garissa was an aggression from KDF.
Jeff, the dozen, my sincere condolences are out to our own security boys who were killed by the bandits, as well as the Kenyan civilians. But were they killed by the entire population, Pokot population of Kapedo? Were they killed by that whole section of Kenya and Kenyans itself? No. Every major genocide that took place in this country had a genesis similar to what exactly is happening right now. In Garissa, 5 military guys were killed in the center of the town by bandits, by terrorists, by Al-Shabaab most likely.
Yeah.
Instead of chasing the Al-Shabaabs, they decided every Somali is a bandit. Every Somali is
a
terrorist.
That's why I condemned.
And then they went out there and they robbed in excess of 1.8 billion Kenya shillings, literally destroyed one of the most powerful markets, similar to Garissa Lodge, which is called Somugdi in Garissa, and brought down the livelihood of thousands of Kenyans to ashes. The same is what is happening right now in Kapedo, in Turkana. It happened also in Wagala. When Wagala massacre took place, initially the whole idea was to maintain security. 6 innocent civilian Kenyans were killed. The military was deployed to do law and order.
Jeff, let's be very honest. We are leaders.
Yes.
On one side, we are telling government, you must secure our internal borders. That you must secure us from cattle rustlers. You must secure us from terrorists, from drug dealers. At the same time, when government, and today, up to today, a parliamentary committee is visiting Kapedo tomorrow to go and investigate. Up to today, no concrete evidence has been provided as far as the operation is concerned. Mm. But the fundamental question is that, and each and every Kenyan, regardless of his political affiliation, is that we must have a secure nation.
State of the nation.
Yes, where our children can go to school, where we can do business. But I can tell you, under the new constitution, under the KDF Act, KDF itself will not violate and do human rights violation. If they are doing it in Kapedo, I can tell you the chief of general staff, General Karangi,
yes,
will take his men who do that who violate human rights. He take them to the court martial.
Why didn't he do it in Gariza? Why didn't he do it in Gariza?
Let's take a break, gentlemen.
Listen to me, Jeff. Why did not do it in Gariza?
Why didn't they do it?
Why didn't they do it in Westgate?
Gentlemen, Westgate. Don't let me use this. Let me use it. Don't let me use it.
Use it.
Your security is behind us.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Your tweets are coming. Let me, there's a real one. Shylock Hassan Ali says, Jeff, please tell Duale we will only accept their lullaby if Olelenku is not only sacked, but jailed for failing in his duty.
That's too extreme.
It's not extreme.
It's against the constitution.
At Faramalim.
How do you jail him?
At Honorable. Why are you honorable?
Because I won my elections
at in 2013. Honorable at Honorable Aiden Duale. At Kenanga Jeff, the hashtag is JKL. Goodness gracious me, I thought it was cold here tonight.
I'm telling you.
It's starting to warm up. It must be the students from Daystar University.
Shout out.
Oh my. Oh my, what my. JKL takes a break. We'll be back in a moment.